Okay, I've just hit the record button, and it's just about 7. I'll defer to Rob if you're all set as far as attendance here this evening to get going.
Hi, Andy. Can everyone hear me?
Sure can.
Excellent. Well, welcome, everybody. So I think just for purposes of format, and again, this is Rob Ciampetti, I'm going to say that we should just, so that anyone logged on observing, or I'm sorry, here, you know, listening and monitoring what we're doing, just give your name when you start to speak so that it's clear as everyone starts to, you know, comment along the way. If we can do that, that'll make it a little bit easier, though, I think. And Andy, correct me if I'm wrong, will it show up under participants as to who's speaking and when?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Great. Do you want to go through the format intro first, or do you want me to go for a roll call of attendance to see?
Let me just give Rob. I'll just give a quick introduction to anybody who's new to this online meeting stuff. So this is a new platform we're using. We've upgraded a little bit in terms of features for our public meetings, but it's the Zoom platform. There are a couple of tools in there for the general public. The board members have a little bit more ability to speak during the meeting. Obviously, that's for obvious reasons. But members of the general public who are interested in speaking on a particular application or anything related to the agenda, there's a raise hand button. That's a feature in Zoom, regardless of whether you're using a computer or the mobile app. And if you raise your hand, the chair or I will unmute you and allow you to speak during public comment at the applicable times of the meeting or the application that's being heard. So with that, if anybody has any questions, you know, or needs to pull anything up during the meeting, like a visual or a graphic, I'll also be handling that in the background to make sure that runs smoothly. So we'll be pulling up any plans or renderings that have been submitted by the applicants just to help the discussion along as we would be during in a physical meeting if it were at City Hall. So with that, I'll return to the chair.
Okay, thank you, Andy. And again, for the Zoom meeting, this is Rob Ciampetti, chairman. We'll start by verifying that we have a quorum for our meeting. So I will ask our board secretary if we could do a roll call for purposes of quorum. Let's see. Doesn't look like, you know what, as I'm looking through, and Andy, as I'm looking through the panelists, I see myself, you as moderator, Ken Swanton, Stephen Delisle, Walter Bud Channon, Caitlin and Mark Moore, and Gretchen Joy, our note taker. So why don't we do it this way? Because do we know, is this everyone who's going to be logging on for the meeting?
To my knowledge, Caitlin may have heard from someone else, maybe, perhaps, but...
This is it. Ed Cameron will be trying to join us as well.
Okay. Why don't I start then? I'll do the roll call for purposes of assessing quorum, and we'll move forward that way. So we'll be taking a roll of the Newburyport Zoning Board of Appeals. This is the meeting of April 28th, 2020 via Zoom. All those in attendance, as I say your name, just please respond by giving your name and saying aye. Ken Swanton?
Ken Swanton, aye.
Excellent, thank you. Mark Moore?
Mark Moore, hello.
Stephen Delisle?
Stephen Delisle, aye.
Walter Channon?
Walter Channon, aye.
And Walter, welcome to the board. Do you prefer to be called Bud?
Yeah, if that's okay, sure.
Yep. Sure, that's okay. Bud Channon, and then I believe that in myself, Rob Ciampetti, I'm present as well. In addition to the members of the board who have identified themselves and responded aye to the attendance, we also have in attendance Caitlin Sullivan, our planner, as well as, of course, Andy Port, our planning director. And then Gretchen Joy, who will be recording and taking notes as she does when we're in live meetings. So it appears we have in attendance Five of us, that's a quorum. Do I have that correct? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes.
Yep.
So we have a quorum and we can proceed with the business of the Zoning Board of Appeals for the meeting of April 28th.
Okay, I'm actually going to throw up on the screen just for everybody's convenience, the agenda for tonight's meeting.
Okay.
And so what we'll see here is, I don't know, Chair, if you wanted to reserve the approval of minutes till the end of the meeting or not, if you wanted to handle those first off.
Let's take care of those right away. And you know what? I'm trying to minimize my screen so I can see the other things that are up. Bear with me just a sec. Okay. All right. So we've done our roll call. We'll go into the business meeting section of our agenda. Approval of the minutes of both March 10th and March 24th are before us. Are there any members of the board in attendance who have any comments, revisions, changes to the minutes of both 3/10 and 3/24/2020? Hearing no responses in the affirmative, I'll make a motion then to, can I have a motion from someone from the board to approve the minutes as drafted?
This is Ken Swanton. I move we approve the minutes of both March 10th and March 24th.
Seconded, Mark Moore.
All right, Ken Swanson having made the motion, Mark Moore having seconded, the motion's made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Actually, if you can just say your names, if you would.
Ken Swanton, aye.
Mark Moore, aye.
Stephen Delisle, aye.
Rob Shagman, aye.
Rob Champetti, aye. The ayes have it, the motion carries, the minutes are adopted. So we can move now, guys, to the next matter in the business meeting, which is a request for variance extension 342 Merrimack Street. This is a matter that had come before us originally, and I think for those of you that have taken a look at the staff report, I believe, Andy, what was the date that was originally before us?
Sorry, that was May of 2019, I think.
Okay. Oh, thank you. And so Andy's got the plans up before us. Is there someone in attendance that wishes to raise their hand, and then Andy Port will be able to unmute you to present any information that isn't otherwise before us for purposes of the request for an extension, or otherwise we'll just move on what we have.
Sure, yep, I'm just gonna unmute Attorney Mead, who's in the audience.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lisa Mead, Mead, Tellerman, Costa, 30 Green Street, on behalf of the permit holder, the Lynches, and we're requesting an extension for 6 months from May 29th, from May 29th, 2020. As we noted in the letter, the detail that has been necessary to prepare on the restoration of the historic structure on this property and other finances have delayed the getting of the special permit. However, we have applied for and in front of the planning board at the upcoming meeting. So we are moving diligently forward, but we will need an extension, particularly given the current situation.
Okay, and this is Rob Champetti, Chair. Thank you, Attorney Mead. So members of the board, we have an applicant's articulation of the reasons by which they need further extension. It's ordinary in the course for this board to grant an extension, of a reasonable enough amount of time to allow for members to get done the business that, you know, that stands between them and them being able to move forward. 6 months is very ordinary in that course. Do we have any comments or does anyone from the board wish to speak with respect to the request? Okay, seeing no hands raised and no one speaking, do we have a motion to approve the request for an extension of the variance for 6 months as requested by Attorney Mead on behalf of her client?
This is Mark Moore. I'll make a motion to approve the six-month extension, the variance in 342 Merrimack Street, file number 2019-033.
Stephen Delisle, I'll second the motion.
Okay, the motion's made by Mark Moore and seconded by Stephen Delisle. All those in favor, please respond by giving me your name and saying aye.
Mark Moore, yes, or aye.
Ken Swanton, aye.
Stephen Delisle, aye.
Ed Shagnon, aye.
Rob Champetti, aye. The ayes have it, the motion carries, and the variance request to be extended 6 months is approved. Thank you. All right, so moving through our agenda to the next, this is actually, we're going to go into the public hearing section under the agenda number 3. And although we have an order that starts with 1250 4th Street with Attorney Mead's courtesy and permission, I'd like to just juxtapose 29 Warren Street first for timing matters. I believe the applicant also serves on a on another board that has a hearing this evening, so we are trying to accommodate that applicant. Attorney Mead, do you have any objection to that?
I have no objection.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. So with that, we're going to swap 1254th Street with 29 Warren Street and do 29 Warren Street first. 29 Warren Street, Brian and Aaron Callahan. There's two matters before us. Matter 2020-020, dimensional variance to construct an addition resulting in a 3.6-foot setback where 10 feet is required, and 2020-021, a special permit for nonconformities to construct an addition resulting in the extension of a pre-existing nonconforming front setback and increase of lot coverage. May we hear from the applicant, Mr. or Ms. Callahan?
Yeah, this is Brian Callahan. Thank you, Ms. Mead, for letting me go first. I'm on the school committee and our meeting started at 6:30, so I'm just trying to be able to get back to that if I could. Thank you.
Absolutely. Feel free to jump into your presentation, Mr. Callahan.
So as you can see in the drawing, the existing, we'll call it a barn structure. It's not quite a barn. It's more of a disaster, but it is a basic rectangle. It currently sits exactly on the property line on the west side of the property. Extends back, roughly 30 feet-ish or so. And we want to tear it down, which the historic people have already given us permission to do, and then build the proposed structure in its space, which actually gives us room further away from the property line, all the way down the length of the building from north to south. And that will become, the second floor will be, I guess, great room type of space, no bedrooms up there. And then the bottom floor will still be quote-unquote garage space, mostly storage, as the door can only be 8 feet wide, which is not wide enough for a car, which is fine for us anyway. So the bottom floor is basically storage, and the second floor is great room space connected through the newly added mudroom space where the two structures will be joined.
Okay. Mr. Callahan, was there anything further that you wanted to add as part of your presentation?
I don't believe so. This is the first time I've ever done this. Of course, I'm not an attorney. Is there anything you guys want to ask of me regarding the drawings or the intention of the project?
Well, you know, that's a perfect segue into something I believe I omitted, just in sort of the the disruption of change of format. Normally in public hearings, when we're in person in City Hall, I'll go through a very short sort of description of the flow of a meeting, which I'll do right now just for purposes of information. So the way the meetings work, and this is for the Callahans as well as anyone else listening that is yet to present, we will go through a format, under Robert's rules, where we will announce and describe the application before us and the legal notice. At which point we will open public hearings. And what we do is we hear from the applicant first in presentation of the application. When we hear from an applicant, we also can hear from an applicant's representative, attorney, engineer, architect, etc. After we hear the presentation, and this is not a sort of a closed and locked door, but it's the sequence and flow of the process, we will then ask of the members of the audience, in this case, it would be the virtual audience, whether anyone wishes to speak in support of the application. Anyone who does wish to speak in support, we'll ask them to identify themselves, especially in this instance, by name and address. so that our note taker can record that information for purposes of the minutes. We will then, after polling the room, or we'll call it the virtual room in this instance, we'll ask if anyone in that virtual room wishes to speak in opposition to the application. If there's someone who is not sure whether they are for or against an application, we encourage them to just simply pick a side. They're not married to that by any means, but just say their name, their address, and voice their thoughts for the benefit of the board. After the public comment portion of the hearing is concluded, we will then go to a section called questions from the board. The board may ask questions of an applicant's representative, their professionals, and the board may also echo questions that were raised by the audience. The board is not often asking any questions of the audience, but rather will hear what has been presented. And if that poses a question in a board member's mind, that board member will articulate that audience question in the form of a question of the applicant or the applicant's representatives. After those questions, the board then goes into a section of the hearing called deliberations. Deliberations is when the members of the audience will listen to the board members thinking out loud. And essentially everything that is discussed or contemplated or questioned is all out loud in public, in public view. So the optics of it are completely clear. Board members will deliberate the legal basis of the application, after which they will close deliberations, and the chairman will ask for a motion. Under Robert's Rules of Order, the motion's always in the affirmative. A motion to approve doesn't mean it's going to be approved. It's just how it's framed. So a member will make a motion to approve. That motion has to be seconded, and then the board will vote. The application, in order to be successful, has to have a minimum of 4 votes in the affirmative. In this instance, we have 5 members, so we have a quorum plus an extra voting member. So that's essentially how it all goes, and my apologies for not doing that first. So we may have questions of you, Mr. Callahan, and we'll try to be very brief. So I'll open it up at this point to any members of the virtual audience that wish to speak in support of this application. Hearing none, anyone wish to speak in opposition? And Andy, will you see someone who raises their hand and open their mic?
Yes, Chair, I was actually gonna just note that. So I'm monitoring the attendance list, both the panelists and the attendees from the general public. So far, no one has raised their hand. I will flag that for you. If you don't notice it yourself, I will flag it for you. Thank you.
All right, roger that, thank you. Seeing no one in opposition, we move to the next section, questions from the board. Does any member of the board have any questions for Mr. Callahan regarding the application? Seeing no hands raised. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just had a question. This is Ken Swanton. So, Mike, I walked by the other day and looked at it, and I see you had an old barn there, like right on the property line. So I understand this new addition won't go right up to the property line. It will only go to like 3.6 feet away, I think, per the drawing.
I'm sorry, go ahead. Yep.
So my question is, I mean, I know you're only 2.3 feet on the other side, so that, you know, you're hugging the borders on both sides. So I guess my question is, did you consider going not quite as close, like 5 feet? I realize the 10 feet that the city requires wouldn't leave you much of an addition, but did you look at going a little less, or was 3.6 where you needed to get to make this work?
Well, I think, and if you don't mind, my architect just texted me saying he can join. I don't know if that's okay, if he can get into this meeting. If he has any actual questions, I'm just giving him the ID right now. Sorry about me being not very prepared here.
No.
I'm just giving him the ID. He may chime in. His name will be Matt McEckern from Emeritus Development. He may chime in. I just gave him the ID. But to answer your question, sir, really it's because if we reduced the size of the room, if you look at the north elevation, I guess if you could bring that up, Rob, I don't know if you're controlling that. As-built.
But Andy's bringing it up now.
Okay, Andy. It's not the as-built. That one. So if you look, the window that is adjacent to the current structure, that is the current side door, I guess. It will become a window. And then the new main, you know, the new side door there, the on the right hand side of the of that window is goes into a mudroom, which is where the staircase is to the second floor. So where the staircase goes up, that's taking up whatever that number is, 3.5 feet, or whatever the legal width is, reducing the final width of everything, second floor and first floor. So that's why the architect said, well, if we can move it further away, you know, that 3.6 feet, and then that's why it's an L shape too, because as you go south, it jogs away again, because the property line is kind of at an, is not kind of, it's actually at an angle for the whole distance of the property. You can see how it angles down. So it's a consistent, you know, 3.5 feet away the entire length of the building, instead of being just the rectangle. So the, at, otherwise the southwest corner would have hugged the property line again. So really, honestly, it's because without that extra 2 or 3 feet, it'd be so narrow in there, especially with the staircase taking up part of the east side of that addition. My architect, Matt McGeckern, just says he just came on. So I don't know if you want to be able to unmute him, Andy, or however that works in this.
Yep, I'm just looking at the list here. I don't quite see him in there. Is he?
He's at the very bottom, Andy.
Yes, I just see him. He just arrived. Yep.
Okay. Hello?
And you are unmuted.
Okay. All right, Matt, you're on, buddy.
No, hey, Brian, how are you?
Good. Everybody, this is Matt McGeckern, my architect. He is the principal of Emeritus Development on Nantucket. And here he is. So, Matt, they had a question about why we didn't make the setback from the west side basically like 5 feet instead of the 3.5 feet. And I said my opinion was to make it more usable space in the building itself. And I'll let you take over for that.
Yeah, that's pretty accurate. I mean, I'm just trying to max out, obviously make the condition better than it was, but then still have some, you know, usable space in there. I mean, as it is, I feel like it's actually kind of tight and slightly awkward space. I think that if we offset that by another 2 feet, I actually think the space would be kind of useless. Yeah, that's a good slide there. You know, I think they want to still be able to utilize the garage for storage. And I'd say, like, if you took an additional 2 feet off of there, it essentially becomes a hallway, if you will. So the thought was that because it's an angled property line and that we're not, and we're actually stepping the building back, you know, it's actually perpendicular and parallel to the existing house. And obviously the property line is not perfectly parallel. And so in that regard, we feel like it's more of this, like the corners that are the closest part. And then every subsequent foot, it's kind of becoming further and further away and closer to that 5 foot, 5 foot setback. So that was the rationale.
This is just Ken Swanson. Just thank you very much for the complete answer. Thank you.
Sure. Sure.
Okay, this is Rob Champetti, chairman again. Anyone else from the board wish to ask any questions of either Mr. Swanson? I'm sorry, is it Mr. Swanson?
No, that's me.
Oh, sorry.
Mr. McGeckern is the architect.
Yeah, I don't know why I had a mental block. Is there any anyone who wishes to ask any additional questions of either the applicant or the applicant's architect, both of whom are online?
This is Stephen Delisle. Just to sort of delve a little bit deeper, following up on Mr. Swanton's question. So it's the kind of strange angle of the property line here on this west side or south side that is the driver for the need for the variance, and the way that the existing structure sort of hugs that line drives the design.
Correct. Yeah. I mean, we thought that it was important that the addition, you know, support or enhance the existing historic structure. You know, obviously the fact that the existing garage is, you know, not perpendicular and parallel, and I'm self-confessed have borderline obsessive compulsive disorder with trying to line things up. But in this instance, I thought that it would serve and support the architecture of the existing structure more successfully. And it actually does it at to the detriment, if you will, of the available, you know, square footage. I think that this slide demonstrates pretty accurately in terms of how much square footage, you know, if you were to take the approach of, okay, we want to just essentially rebuild the existing structure in the same exact footprint, you know, whether that would be allowable or not, but just in, if that was possible, just by squaring the building up, you can actually see that you do lose a percentage of available square footage. So it's generally a loss. I do think it's important to provide, obviously, you know, just for, you know, separation between adjacent property owners, you know, excavation, a number of reasons to clearly, you know, to build it off the property line is as much as reasonable. And again, I think at the point where it's the closest, it's at 3.6 feet. But if you actually took similar dimensions at every other point, say at, you know, 1 foot intervals, you would get to that 5 foot setback, pretty quickly. But again, I'd say that one of the primary drivers for me anyways, in talking with Brian was just, you know, I think that in terms of, you know, it's a great neighborhood, and Newburyport as a whole is just a special place, you know, to have the addition support the architecture was one of our bigger drivers, even though it does actually result in a net reduction in allowable or usable square footage compared to the existing.
This is Stephen Delisle again, Mr. McEachern, just to kind of tease out a little bit more information. So if the plan had been to rebuild the structure in the current location, that would cause problems relative to the property line and the neighbor's property, and you're seeking to avoid that?
That's one of the drivers. I mean, the truth is, if necessary, you know, I've worked on a number of projects here on Nantucket where, you know, we don't have that luxury where you do actually have to replace an existing footprint in a, such a close proximity. And there are methods to achieve that, but they're complex and costly, and you know, it's you can, you know, it's again for the adjacent property owner, it can be a problem. So it certainly was one of the factors in our decision making process.
And if I may comment, Brian Callahan, you know, if it were me, you know, no architect, but certainly know what I think looks good in terms of the city, the existing buildings on such a strange angle with the rest of the house to join it would be a bizarre kind of 30 degree angled hallway coming off. So from the street side, it would look like a mistake, really, if you tried to join the two buildings together without a straight line.
Okay. This is Rob Champetti, chair again. Were there any further sort of dovetails to that question or any other questions by any members of the board? All right, hearing no, and seeing no hands raised, hearing no voices, we can move along to deliberations. And just sort of for purposes of framing our deliberations, we have two matters before us. We have both the, bear with me a sec, we have a variance application, as well as the special permit for nonconformities. So, as we deliberate, we should deliberate around in determining whether or not the variance criteria is met under 10H. We should focus our deliberations around whether the conditions and circumstances are unique to the applicant's lot, structure, building, and to approve a variance would not be giving a special permission to this particular applicant. Strict application of the provisions of this chapter would deprive the applicant of reasonable use of the lot, structure, building in a manner equivalent to the use permitted to be made by other owners in the neighborhood or district. That the unique conditions and circumstances are not the result of the actions of the applicant taken subsequent to the adoption of zoning. And finally, relief will not constitute a grant of special privilege, which I believe I mistakenly kind of referenced earlier, and that this privilege being inconsistent with the limitations on the properties in the district. So convoluted though that is our variance criteria. So let's try to focus our deliberations around that as well as the special permit criteria.
Hey, this is Mark Moore, and just to, I guess, dovetail off the discussion that we kind of end with in questions, at least on the variance side, I mean, when you look at the where the current garage is situated, how it's situated with respect to the house, I think it's clear to me that with the angles on that side of the property and the way everything's placed, that that's a pretty unique setup and very unique condition. So I could see that being taken care of, and it was explained very well, I thought, in questions. When you look at what their proposed addition is going to do for the property and for the applicant, just taking a look at the neighborhood, it appeared to me that, you know, many in that neighborhood have enjoyed the same type of addition and same type of additional property, I guess is the best way to put it, or add on to what seemed to be the original house. So I don't see that being any special advantage if a variance was granted. The garage is basically, or not basically, it is on the line. So even the proposed addition improves conditions right now of what's there. And as cited earlier, that, you know, with similar properties and similar additions in the neighborhood, I don't see this being anything different than what's going on in that area. So I think all the criteria have been met, at least on the variance side in my mind, but I don't know how anyone else feels.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. Chairman Rob Ciampetti, does anyone else wish to deliberate on the points of the variance application?
Yeah, this is Ken Swanton. I think Mark said it pretty well. I mean, this is a barn that's been there for a long time because it's called a garage on the map. I think Mike probably more correctly called it a barn. And it's right on the line. And even though it'd be nice if this thing, the new thing, was further from the line, this is a big improvement over what it was. And I think, as Mr. Delisle pointed out, this is a really tilted lot line, as Mark also said. So, you know, I would agree that this seems to be a reasonable proposal.
Okay. Anyone else wish to speak during deliberations regarding the criteria for the variance portion of the application?
This is Stephen Delisle. I would just echo what Mr. Swanton has said. I think that the four criteria that we went through that the chairman listed off have been satisfied with respect to this variance application. And I think that, you know, it looks like a nice project, and the special permit criteria are likely, in my mind, satisfied as well.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Delisle. Anyone else? Okay, before we move along in a motion, I want to point out the second component, the second prong of this application is an application for a special permit for nonconformities under 9B2. The criteria that the board must find is that this proposal is not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the pre-existing nonconforming use or structure. So essentially, we just need to deliberate, make findings with respect to the second prong of this, whether the board feels that the proposal as proposed is substantially more detrimental than existing conditions. So if I can open that up to the board to just comment, and we can move things along as well.
Hey, Mark Moore here, and I probably muddled them both together earlier, but no, it's certainly, in my mind, not more detrimental. There's many similar looking structures in the neighborhood, so I don't see it in mass or size or any other way being different than what's in that neighborhood, so.
Yeah, this is Ken Swanton, and in some ways it's an improvement for I love old structures, but the barn has seen better days, and the drawings look good. So, I mean, I don't see it being detrimental at all.
This is Stephen Delisle. I would agree with Messrs. Swanton and Moore.
Bud Shagnon, I agree as well. I don't feel it's detrimental. If anything, I would vote that it's an improvement, and again, in keeping with the neighborhood.
Chairman Rob Champetti, I have to agree with my colleagues. I think that this is a wonderful and certainly thoughtful adaptive reuse and certainly is consistent with the neighborhood. And I believe I agree with my colleagues with respect to the variance criteria as well as the special permit criteria. I'll also point out that the application does not appear to trigger the tree and sidewalk ordinance. So and the planning office has not received any comments on the project, whether pro or against. So there is no there's no objections on file to the application, and other than what we've heard in support, and otherwise that is essentially all the news fit to print. Okay, so if I may, I'll go ahead and close deliberations, and I will ask for a motion on. We'll start with the variance application for 29 Warren Street.
It's Mark Moore. I'll make a motion to approve the variance application for 29 Warren Street, file number 2020020.
Ken Swanson, second.
Okay, the motion's made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Swanson on the variance application. I will go ahead and call the roll. Mr. Swanson.
Mr. Swanson, aye.
Mr. Moore.
Mr. Moore, yes.
Mr. Delisle.
Mr. Delisle, yes.
Mr. Chenyon.
Mr. Chenyon, aye.
Rob Champetti, I vote aye. That is 5 in the affirmative. The ayes have it. The motion carries. The variance is approved. May I have a motion on the special permit for nonconformities?
Mark Moore, may as well keep going. I'll make a motion to approve the special permit for nonconformities for 29 Warren Street, application number 2020021.
Seconded by Ken Swanson.
Motion's made and seconded. Motion's made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Swanson on the special permit for nonconformities. Mr. Swanson.
Mr. Swanson, aye.
Mr. Moore.
Yes. Mr. Moore, yes.
Mr. Delisle.
Mr. Delisle, yes.
Mr. Chenyon.
Chenyon, aye.
Rob Champetti, aye. That's 5 in the affirmative. The ayes have it. The motion carries. The special permit for nonconformities is approved. Thank you very much, everyone, and thank you to Mr. Callahan for your service on our school committee under certainly unprecedented circumstances. Good luck to you.
All right. Thank you very much, everybody. Good night.
All right.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.
All right. Moving then back in sequence, we will now move to the matter of 1254th Street. The application is on behalf of Gregory Elliott and Candace McMahon, application 2020-019, a special permit for nonconformities continued from the meeting of March 24th, 2020, to construct a single story addition to footprint and second story addition above the existing section of the single family structure on a pre-existing non-conforming lot. The applicant's represented by attorney Lisa Mead. Attorney Mead.
Hello. Rob, can you hear me?
I can.
Okay, thank you. I didn't have the unmute sign come up, so I apologize. No, Lisa Mead, Mead Tellerman Costa, on behalf of Gregory Elliott and Candace McCann. As you said, this is a proposal for a special permit for nonconformities. The project is located in the R3 zoning district and the Plum Island Overlay District. Originally, the proposal had to go to the Historic Commission because there's a roof line change. The gable end that faces the street is changing, as well as there's going to be an addition put on top as a second floor for a bedroom. And the Historic Commission approved and released the project from demo delay, commenting, as you can see in your notes, that the proposal is more likely to enhance the district rather than distract from the streetscape. The structure is pre-existing non-conforming for a couple of reasons. The front yard setback is 9.6, where 20 feet is required. The lot area is 9,500 square feet, where 12,000 is required. I might note, if you could go to the site plan, Andy, if you wouldn't mind. I might note that, in fact, for Plum Island, this is a pretty large lot. Generally speaking, you've got 4,900 square foot lots on the island. This is 9,500 square feet, almost twice. Most of the lots around it are the 4,900 square feet, but for the ones directly behind it, which are actually are a quarter of that size, they're particularly small lots for the island. But in any event, it's 9,500 square feet. The side yard setback on the eastern side of the structure is 5.01, where 20 is required. I would also note here that the addition is going in the middle of the existing structure under what would be considered the original cottage, and is not extending out to the 5.1 feet, but will stay 14.1 feet away from that eastern sideline. So the structure also continues to meet the FAR. It's not going to go over the FAR. And it will also exceed the current height, but will be in conformance with the ordinance at under 30 feet. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to John Sava, who should be on your list. And he's going to talk about the architecture on this. Is Mr. Sava on the list, Andy?
Yes, Andy.
Excellent.
Yeah, hi, Andy.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I've maiden voyage here on this type of format. So if I'll apologize beforehand. I'll make a fool out of myself here. But yeah, the house, as Lisa had mentioned, has good bones on it. And to put a second story on it, we had to do a structural analysis for it, and the footings and foundations can handle it. I've done a number of houses, as you probably know, on the island, and I'm sort of originally a summer person there, my parents having built a house in the 30s. So I'm kind of used to these older, small houses. This one happens to be have been built quite well, but it was built in 1920. So we really don't know when those additions had happened to it, but whoever did it quite well. Concrete block foundations, no cracks. But my real emphasis here is that I try to be as sympathetic to the surroundings as I can and still respond to my client's requests. So I, as Lisa had mentioned, the south elevation is facing the street. And presently there's a gable roof that comes right out to the edge of the setback. And that roof, I actually turned and sloped it from the street up to approximately where the chimney is. That did a couple of things. It softened the house, the blow of the house, if you would, on 54th Street. It also gave neighbors an opportunity to get a better look at the basin. So it did two things. And the other thing that happened was, we, as Lisa again mentioned, on the 5.1 setback side, we chose not to put an addition at that point. We came in nine feet. So again, with the attempt at trying to soften the blow here as best we could, and still take care of our clients' needs. So the other thing that we did do, the only thing we did other than we kept the house on the existing footprint, but there is a smaller screen porch actually on the northerly side that we wanted to put there because anytime you can get out of the greenheads, the midges, and the mosquitoes, it doesn't have to be big, but it, if you can get outside, that's a good thing. So that's the only real change, and even with that, we're well within our footprint, and we're within our 25% lot coverage. The house is surrounded by larger houses. And so this is really kind of the last remaining token small house, but the clients are very much cramped in this house. And of course you hear that a lot, but in this particular case, it's true. And we tried to match materials that are indigenous to the island, roof lines, porches, decks, little lookout area there. So that's essentially the project. Over.
Thank you, John.
Mm-hmm.
So if I could, Andy, if you could go to the lower left-hand elevation, just, and that shows the screened-in porch where the three long, looks like, openings are. Just to point with your cursor down on the right here on this. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. So that's the screened in porch you can see in the back. That is the change in the footprint. So the standard for review under the PIOD is two things. One is the proposed change will not be substantially more detrimental to the existing nonconforming structure to the neighborhood or the PIOD. And the second is that there will not cause the structure to be within 10 feet. The side lot line more than two stories or more than 35 feet in height. So if I take the second one first, we don't do any of those. And so we meet that criteria. The height is gonna be 30.7 feet. So it's about 5 feet shorter than what the maximum is. And we don't come within 10 feet of the side lot line, and it's not more than two stories. So the second criteria is whether or not it will be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing non-conforming structure or the PIOD. And in this instance, I'd like to say a couple of things. Certainly we can go back to the comments from the Historic Commission, which they themselves thought that it would certainly enhance and not distract from the streetscape. Secondly is that John said, as he noted, and one of the things he did forget is that he was very careful not to keep or to keep the ceilings and the pitch of the roof lower in the house so that it didn't become this very giant second floor addition. So that's accented by the elevation off of 54th Street where he turns that gable for the first thing. And then secondly, he keeps the house intact, more like a cottage with the second floor on it. Andy, we provided a group of photos of the neighborhood. Do you have those?
Yeah, just 1 second. Let me pull that up.
So while Andy's doing that, let me say there are, this is 554th Street. It's across the street. And if you could go to the next one, please. This is 854th Street. So the one in the middle of the picture is 854th Street, which is right next to the applicant's home, which is the yellowish one. You can see the elevation drops right there. And then you see 654th, which is in the foreground. You could go to the next one, please. Again, that's a closer picture of 854th, which is the house right behind ours. And that actually shows a good, that's a good picture, an angle for John's comment relative to the gable, right being right on 54th Street. Whereas when you turn that roof, it's a softer effect. And it certainly lowers the roof for the house next door. There's 1154th and 954th, which are across the street. And this is the backyard facing for the houses in the rear of the structure. So many of the houses are on piles. Some are one story. The resulting structure will be less than most all of the structures surround it from a height point of view. The expansion of the footprint is for the screened-in porch. and is modest at best. Overall, we believe that the structure is certainly not going to be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood or to the Piod, given that it conforms with all of the restrictions in the overlay district, and that we continue to stay under the more restrictive provisions of the special permit criteria, namely the FAR, the height, and the setbacks. We've received and provided to the board and to the city four letters in support from abutters. And there was a comment relative to street trees and sidewalks. We don't believe that provision applies because it's not a substantial rehab, which will make it, that will be determined certainly by the building inspector and the Conservation Commission. If it is, if you were to look at the my maps, which I don't think there is a, I don't think there is a photo of my maps on there, but there's no, there are no trees in this area. You'd have to get permission from CONCOM to do that, and there are no sidewalks. So we're happy to comply if it's triggered, but I don't believe it will be triggered, and we would be happy with the board's standard condition in that regard. So this is received approval from the Historic Commission. Now we're before the Zoning Board. And then once we're done with the zoning board, we'll be going to the Conservation Commission, which we are on their agenda for, but for all the reasons that are obvious, those meeting dates have gotten a little jumbled and we'll be going there next. Thank you, Mr. Tudor.
Okay, thank you, Attorney Mead, Chairman Rob Champetti. Having heard from the applicant in support of the application, I'm going to open it up to the members of the public, the virtual public, anyone who wishes to speak in support of the application. Seeing no hands, anyone wish to speak in opposition to the application?
And we do have one person I'm unmuting right now, Lynn Murray.
Excellent, thank you.
Hello.
Hello, Ms. Murray. Please, if you could just state your name and your address for the record. This is Chair Champetti again, just so that we can keep our records moving smoothly.
Thank you, Chair Champetti. My name is Lynn Murray, and I live at 854th Street, Newburyport, Mass.
Thank you, Ms. Murray. And what do you wish to say?
All right. We are the, my husband Richard and I are the eastern facing abutters and the structure you directly saw right behind their house. The setback from the property line on their side is 5 feet, on our side is 5 feet. The upward addition of that second floor is going to be basically having us looking at a wall. Our deck and living space overlook the subject property facing the west, and from these vantage points, we can see over the existing roof height of 19 inches and into the neighborhood and have a view of the basin. This proposed project will have a direct and significant impact on the use and of enjoyment of our property. The upward addition of the proposed height will impact directly on our privacy, light source, airflow, and views. I'm sorry, my husband would like to speak.
Yeah, if you look at the floor plan that I'm looking at right now, second floor plan, that house is facing west, so we're facing east looking at this picture, and you can't see my house from there. It's there, it's right behind it.
Yeah, but that's a drawing.
It's a drawing, but it's right behind that house. You can't see it.
Mr. Murray, this is Chairman Champetti. If I might interrupt for just a moment, Andy, could we pull up the photos that might are part of the application that might show, for purposes of the board, the perspective that's being described by the Murrays?
Yes, definitely.
All right, and Mr. Murray, if I could ask you, if you don't mind, sir, could you also just give your name and your, we know your address, of course, but if you could give your name for our note taker, I would appreciate that.
Yeah, my name is Richard Murray. I'm with 854 Street, Newburyport.
Thank you, sir. And right now, Mr. Port's going to bring up the photos that I think would be, there we go. So 850 4th Street, this photo, this is Chairman Ciampetti again. Is this your home here?
This is our home, that's correct.
Okay. Mr. Murray, please feel free to continue.
Sir, if I might interrupt, this is their son, Adam Murray. I was just wondering if we have evidence of our own of the alleyway in between the two houses. We have a photograph of that. I'm not seeing any options to show the photograph with screen via the cameras that we have. Is there any way for us to do so?
This is Chairman Ciampetti. I'll defer to Andy Port, who's our moderator for the Zoom conference.
Yeah, the only way I can recommend doing that at this moment is if you have the ability to email it to me right at the moment, I can pull it up and display that.
Yeah, I can try to. Give me a second here.
Sure. Perhaps if there's any further discussion, just during the moment while he's emailing that.
Okay. What we want you to see is there's no pictures that anybody has shown or taken of the existing. You can see the satellite dish on the back of our house. That's our upstairs deck that's attached to. And that's where it's 4 feet on 4 feet from the fence line. Between the properties. 4 feet on their side, 4 feet on our side.
I'm looking.
This is my truck.
Here's your truck.
So, folks, this is Andy Port. I threw up on the screen here just an ortho photo. I thought that might be helpful to orient folks if you wanted to make a description of where things are in proportion or relation.
I'm trying to figure out where I am on here. Hang on.
That's right here. That's what I should.
Okay, because I'm going to want to talk.
All right. You can see the back line of their structure that you have their structure circled with a lot behind it to the right. And I don't even know, can you see how tight that alley is in there? Between their lot line and our lot line right in here?
Andy, excuse me 1 minute if I could just help out. Andy, there you go, right there.
Thank you.
Sorry folks, there's a bit of a delay on when I'm making an adjustment on my end. And so I noticed it has and creates an issue.
Gotcha.
So, I'm sorry, go ahead. Did you want to?
No, are you?
What is your email so I may send?
Email, you please.
It's aport@cityofnewburyport.com.
Thank you.
Looking at.
Okay.
I know. Yeah, I can. Andy?
Yep.
John Sava here, architect. Yep.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Could I address that somewhat?
Sure. Go ahead.
Okay.
That's your objects.
Well, I have a question on a couple things, and I certainly respect. Lynn and Pye's objections and their questions. The site plan that you have, if you could pull that up, because that shows a little more accurately the distance from.
There we go.
Yeah, see the 5.1 feet?
There we go.
That's the 5.1 feet that we have. And then the other hatched line is the is number 8 54th Street, and there's actually from the property line to that house is actually 2 feet 7 or 2 feet 8 inches. It's not 5 feet,
right?
At least that's not what this shows. And there is in fact a fence that goes right on the property line Again, I it's hard to say what happened in 1920 to 1930. The house that Lynn and Pi have was built in 1930. So after it was built after, of course, number 12. So whoever built that addition, and I don't think that Lynn and Pi did that, built the addition pretty darn close to the existing house that had been there for 30 years. So it's just a point to bring up. You know, as Lisa had said, we're starting our two stories. We're starting our two-story structure 14.1 feet away. And I tried to keep it as low as I could. So that's about all I can add to that.
Just jumping in here, this is Andy Port. Photographs that were emailed to me, I'm just pulling those up now on the screen. So if any reference wanted to be made to those, I can flip through
those. I've also sent a couple more photographs of our sight lines of the existing roof and where the chimney is located in reference to where what we see and what we will see.
I'm sorry, this is Chairman Champetti again. Can I just ask, and I certainly am trying my best to recognize my voice, but could you just...
This please... is Adam Murray. I'm the son of Reginald Murray.
What your name, sir?
Adam Murray.
Okay, Adam Murray. Great, thank you. Thank you for that. So, Andy, and this is Chairman...
Sorry.
That's okay, Miss Murray. So we're looking at photographs provided by... Adam Murray, your son.
Correct.
Could you scroll through each of the photographs that Adam Murray has just emailed so that we can see them all?
Okay.
That's not me.
I know I scroll.
That's not me. I am not in control of that.
No, yeah. This will
Andy. So this is Andy here.
You got it. Okay. All right.
I have the photographs. I can flip through those if you want to make any description. Okay. You know, the relationship between the structures or the space or anything.
Right. What you're looking at is our house on the left with the gas tank and the oil tank, and Greg and Candy's house on the right-hand side of the picture. That fence is on the property line between the two houses. Their properties to the right of that white fence, our properties to the left of that white fence. And that's how close the houses are.
This is Chairman Champetti. Just to be clear, yeah. If we were to imagine looking beyond the frame of this photo to the right, that's the basin, correct? We're looking to the right toward the basin.
Correct. To the right is the basin.
I mean, I know that, but I want to make sure anyone else that might be listening.
Okay. Looking at it.
Please continue. Thank you.
This is just a view from the other end. This is the street end of 54th Street, looking back through that same alleyway.
Okay.
Between the houses. Yeah, a bird's eye view from my deck looking down.
There are another two pictures that I've sent in a later email.
Yeah, this is Andy. Just give one second, I'll pull those up.
Thank you.
Mr. Champetti, while Andy's doing that, may I just point out a couple of landmarks that, if we could? This is Lisa Mead.
This is Chairman Champetti. Yes, please go ahead.
So if you compare that, thank you, Mr. Chair. If you compare this photograph to the actual site plan, which has been submitted, you'll see that the fence that jogs that's on the right hand side of this photo that has the gate attached to the applicant's house is actually that gate, and then the fence then jogs in. And so the property line is actually closer to the abutter's property than what is being shown, if everybody understands what I'm saying. So you can see the fence on the site plan, and it runs along the property line away from 54th Street. But then when it gets next to the addition on the little bump out on the applicant's property, the fence bumps in, so that the property line is actually 5 feet away from the inside of the fence as the fence runs towards 54th Street. Similarly, if you look at this, and then we'll go back to one of the photos, right? So where the pad is for the propane tank or the pad for the oil is actually right for 1254th Street, the abutters that are speaking. It's right, those amenities, if you will, are right on the property line. And while you look at this site plan, the addition is actually in the center of, if you will, the original cottage. So if you were to take the two appendages off this cottage, so to speak, the addition is right in the center of it and is pulled away from the front 54th Street. So if you go back to those photographs,
Lisa, did you want these photos or the ones that were shown this morning?
This is a good one just for a second. So if you go to this photograph, that gable end is going to come down and turn and be lower than what it exists today. And then if you go to the photos from the abutters, Andy. So you can go back to the first one you just showed. So that gable end is going to be gone on the left. John, you should correct me if I'm in the wrong position here, but I think that's correct. That gable end will be gone. That will be low.
Yeah, correctly. So it starts at the chimney and,
yeah,
and slopes down towards the street. So that wedge portion will be gone.
Right. So it's true that to the right of the chimney from this photo, there will be a second floor that will be on there. But as you look out over there, certainly there's a view of the basin. There's no question about that. But there's a house directly in front there to the left, to the right of the chimney, as well as that tree. So there will be a better view from the left and not from the right. I might add, of course, that nowhere in the Newburyport zoning ordinance is there a purpose that protects views. I just point that out. But nonetheless, this view will change for sure. It will become better on the left, and it certainly will have a second story on the right. But that second story will commence, and if you look down in the center of this photograph, you can see the little addition roof that runs towards 1254th. There, right there. So this second floor is going to commence at the end of that addition, not right up against 1254th Street. We are staying over the original cottage and not carrying up the exact same side setback. As we noted earlier, that addition will be 14.1 feet away, which is 9 feet further than the current setback. So I thought that these photos offered some good perspective, and I wanted to be clear about where the actual property line is.
Okay, this is, thank you, Attorney Mead. This is Chairman Ciampetti again. So just to be clear, if I'm hearing correctly, what we're looking in this photograph that Andy has up right now, to the right of that chimney is where the second story will be. So it'll essentially be occluding everything we see to the right, where the house is just a few right of the chimney, and then that tree that seems closer to the basin. But everything to the left of the chimney will remain the view that's shown right now?
It will be improved because that gable is removed and that roof, that pitch, the eave is dropped because the gable is removed. So that pitch lowers. How much do you think that lowers, John?
Well, it's a pie shape sliced out of it, Lisa. If you can take a look at the west elevation, actually probably the east elevation on my drawing. Yeah, the east elevation. Andy. of my actual architectural drawing, number A2.0. One more. There you go. The east elevation, you can see that that roof now tilts down towards 54th Street, whereas it came out almost to the height of the chimney. So there should be more view going out towards the basin on that side. And yes, you know, this elevation tells a lot. It, you know, there is going to be a house in front of them. You know, you just can't really avoid that. But the view right now towards that, I'm thinking it's a northwesterly view. You're really overlooking houses and you're looking over that tree that you talked about. And yeah, I mean, there's no question that it's going to be blocking that. But I tried the best I could to start that whole process in as delicate, hitting the ground as delicately as I could. It is what it is.
All right, Chairman, this is Chairman Ciampetti again. Mr. Saba, thank you very much. And Attorney Mead, thank you. Mr. and Mrs. Murray, as well as Mr. Adam Murray, did you wish to add anything to what you've already provided us before we move along? And thank you.
Yeah, yes, I do. I'm looking at a picture right now of the back of the house, and there's a line drawn across where the second floor is going to stop. Now, if you flip over to the other photo that we took from our deck that was just on, can you do that for me?
Andy, can we flip to that photo Adam Murray had provided?
Yeah, sorry, folks. It just takes a second for the refresh to go through for everyone, so just be patient. Sorry.
Thank you.
Okay. Just clarify if there's a different photo you want than what I'm showing.
Okay.
That's it.
If you look at this picture, the way I'm looking at this picture was taken from the inside of my house. The top of the railing that you see, you look below the railing, you see the white line. That's their gutter. You go up from that 14 feet to take you up to here. So by noontime, I don't see Newbury, I see Newburyport. I mean, I see Newbury, I don't see Newburyport because there's a house in Newburyport in front of my house in Newburyport. I can look into Newbury, I can't look into Newburyport. That's my opinion. I cannot see the city which one I live if he puts that house in front of my house. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mr. Murray. And Mrs. Murray and Adam and Mr. Adam Murray for your comments as well.
Thank you for your time and listening to what we had to say. We appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Absolutely, ma'am. Okay, so moving along, is there anyone else who wishes to speak in opposition to the application? Anyone else? Seeing no new hands? We will move from the public comment section to questions from the board. Any members of the ZBA who wish to level any questions, just of course, please just give your name first.
Oh, this is Mark Moore. And while this picture is up from the abutter's deck, I'm just looking for some guidance from the applicant to the best of their ability to the right of the chimney. How, if it could be eyeballed, how far up, say, past the tree would this addition be?
Maybe John could answer that. But the mean ridge is 30.7. John, do you have an estimate about where that would be?
Yeah, I just think a professional.
Well, you know.
Guess. I know it's a guess because we can't. You know.
Yeah, it's a guess. The chimney, it will be extended.
Mm-hmm.
Would be extended. But again, you know, the mean height of this house, code mean, all right, is 21 feet. But I like to put the heights of houses on because that's what you really you know, going to look at. So the mean height is actually quite a bit less than the code. Having said that, I believe that that tree that you see is going to be blocked, is my guess. Mm-hmm. And the houses right at the edge will be blocked. But to the right, you know, once you're on the deck, you can certainly look towards the Merrimack River and that whole view towards the north. And again, the view towards the basin on the left of the chimney, which will now be quite a bit, there'd be a lot more breathing room on that side than they have right now.
Okay.
But, that's, I hope that answers your question.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, this is Chairman Ciampetti again. Thank you very much, Mr. Sava. Are there any other questions from the board?
Yes, this is Stephen Delisle. I have a question with respect to the letters of support. Are the residents who provided support for the application, are they also people whose views will be blocked, or are these people that are east of the situs?
Well, excuse me, Mr. Delisle, this is Attorney Mead. So we have 1756 Street, which is right behind or beside. We have 16.
Sorry, Attorney Mead, what cardinal direction would that be?
All right, so if you if you're looking at this photo, since here we are, it's to the right of the applicant's house. Then we have 16.
Sorry, Attorney Mead, I'm going to interrupt again. North, south, east, or west?
This would be, that's the basin. It would be, it's sorry, to the sorry, north.
Lisa, if I could just interject.
Yeah.
This is Andy. I just threw up the ortho photo again, if it's helpful for giving orientation.
Yeah, so I believe that this is the house, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, John. 1756 is right over to the left. It's the, I think it's the larger of those three houses there, maybe. So yeah, it doesn't block. So it's in front of this towards the water, Mr. Delisle. It's it doesn't block the view towards the water. And then the next one is the one immediately in front of it where you see that red truck, 1654. And then 1256, which is the one of the smaller ones behind, and to shore, which is also one towards closer towards the water. Uh-huh. Again, I would just pick up on that comment that there's a couple of things. One, by not employing a total tear down and reconstruction, the house is smaller or less tall than it would otherwise be. And again, there's no provision in the Newburyport zoning ordinance that protects view.
Can I follow up with another question? This is a different, with respect to what's in the ground now for the foundation that that Mr. Sava was describing earlier, what will be in the ground after the project is completed? Could maybe Mr. Sava could just describe the difference there for me. What's in the ground now versus what will be in the ground upon completion?
It will remain exactly the same.
The foundation won't be expanded in any way?
No. It won't. And the addition to the screen porch, that is surrounded on three sides by structure, and we're going to be adding a ledger to the framing, and using joist hangers to span from the existing porch to the house. So this is not a lot of weight on that anyway, But that's going to be done using the existing structure and the sonotubes. So we're not doing anything to the existing structure. It's in great shape. It's concrete blocked. It must have been reinforced. It's actually a footing under it, which is very surprising. And there are no cracks. But no, to answer your question, we're not doing any excavation at all.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, this is Chairman Champetti again. Any other questions from members of the board?
Yeah, I have a question. This is Ken Swanton. My question is, this is in the Piatt out on Plum Island, and it was put in place because it's such a fragile area out there, as we all know. And, as the buildings get bigger and bigger and bigger out there, it puts even more pressure on this very fragile system, which was the reason for the Piatt in the first place. So my question to the applicant is, we have to figure out as a zoning board, if this is, if your proposal is more detrimental than the existing structure to the neighborhood or to the Piatt. And I'm trying to think here, if all the houses on Plum Island get a lot bigger, is that really, how can you argue that is not substantially more detrimental? So I guess that's my question to you. How is making this house so much bigger not substantially more detrimental?
Sure, Mr. Swanton, I think it's an excellent question. Actually, the Plum Island Overlay District in both Newburyport and Newbury were created at the same time pursuant to an administrative consent order entered into by the City of Newburyport and the Town of Newbury with DEP in relation to taking water and sewer out to Plum Island. And the purpose behind the adoption of the Plum Island Overlay District was to assure DEP that there would be limits, there would be a balance between placing limits on renovating and remodeling pre-existing non-conforming structures while at the same time not coming up against the statute under 48 section 6 paragraph 4, which everybody had a right to, and the typical special look that single and two family homes have under your typical finding or special permit for renovating pre-existing non-conforming structures. In particular, given that almost all of Plum Island was pre-existing non-conforming. And so in order to do that, when the zoning was adopted, they said, okay, in the Piatt, we're gonna put more restrictions on what you can put on each one of these lots, as opposed to a typical pre-existing non-conforming structure, either in the City of Newburyport or in the Town of Newbury. And those restrictions included FAR, which you as know is sitting on the Zoning Board of Appeals, does not exist anywhere else in the City of Newburyport. So there's a limitation on FAR so that lot coverage didn't become too large on each of these small pre-existing non-conforming lots, where typically if you extend over lot coverage, you can continue to do that with a special permit. But on Plum Island under the overlay district, yes, you can do that, but only to the extent that you don't exceed the FAR. So that's the first control. The second control was that notwithstanding what the setback requirements were and notwithstanding what the pre-existing non-conforming condition was, you couldn't put any new construction closer than 10 feet to the lot lines. So that was the second control that didn't exist anywhere else in the city. And the third control was that notwithstanding the height limitations anywhere else in the city, you could only add one story and you couldn't have that be taller than 35 feet mean roof height. And so the Piatt said, yes, we're gonna be more restrictive, but here's how you're gonna be able to expand on your property without violating the provisions of Chapter 48, Section 6, Paragraph 1. And so that's what we respect here. In fact, much of that consideration was before the issue related to the FEMA controls and the construction in VE zones and things of that nature, which now, you could tear down this house And you would have to basically, in order to get the same square footage, go up to 35 feet and then have your park under. But if you have, if you do less than substantial construction, which is something that the Conservation Commission has to determine along with the building inspector, you can actually keep the house a little more compact. And so in this instance, it's not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood because A, it stays, while it may have some impact on the most immediate neighbor, the neighborhood in general, it stays more compact than the rest of the neighborhood. It uses less space than the rest of the neighborhood. And it has, and it improves a condition that most people would say is a structure that needs some improvement and that these people can live in the way they need to and would like to live in it. So that would be my answer to that, that in fact, we are complying with the Plum Island Overlay District, which does enforce and require a more conservative reconstruction of pre-existing non-conforming structures.
Thank you, Attorney Mead. This is Chairman Ciampetti again. Was there a follow-on piece to the board's questions of the applicant or anything that we've heard so far?
Here. This is Stephen Delisle. I have one final question here. Did anybody reach out to the Murrays prior to this hearing? Or the filing of this application?
Yes.
Yes, John Sava, architect. I did. I actually know Murray's, and I went over there and showed them the plan and explained to them what we were doing. They had a little bit of confusion involved as to the roof line actually being, you know, dropped in that area so they'd have a little bit better view. And we were in agreement when I left, but we had a good meeting, I thought. But, you know, they certainly are entitled to whatever grievances they may have just initiated. So. But no, absolutely, I reached out to them.
Thank you, Mr. Sava.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sava. This is Chairman Ciampetti again. So moving along, are there any other questions from the board before we move into deliberations? Seeing no hands up from the board members, we'll close that portion of the public hearing and move into deliberations. Keeping in mind that what we have before us, of course, is a special permit for nonconformities, and bear with me just a moment as I pull this up. Special permit for nonconformities under 9B2, et cetera. So the standard is, of course, as we've already heard, that the board must find that there will be no addition of a new nonconformity in order to grant the special permit. And the standard for special permit for nonconformities, of course, is that there is that the proposed alteration is not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood and the conditions as are the existing conditions of the structure without the alteration. So if I can open it up for deliberations from the board.
Well, this is Mark Moore. I'll jump off, at least with my thoughts on this was, it's obviously a complicated, application for lack of a better way to put it. When you have the NHC blessing it, saying it would be an improvement to what's there. And, you know, when you're looking at that street and as evidenced by the pictures, there are a lot of large refurbished, built upwards homes on that street. In fact, I think this is the only one that hasn't been done. So I'm sympathetic to someone owning it and wanting to improve it. I would agree with the applicants that, you know, I don't think it's detrimental to the neighborhood, but it certainly is having an impact on the immediate neighbor. It appears to me that there was an attempt, it basically was a give and take. Yeah, we know we're taking away your complete view, but we've changed one side to give you a better view I guess, of Newbury, which is not sitting right with you, with the abutters, and that's totally understandable when you've had a view like that for forever. But the view to the right of that landing didn't really show a ton, to the right of that chimney, I should say, didn't show a ton other than the homes and a tree. But you could see through, and I understand how you wouldn't want that blocked by a building. So the stumbling point for me is the fact that it seems like there were good faith discussions, and that last comment was there was kind of an agreement to how this would work. It was a give and take. You're going to get a better view this way. It's not so great that way. The only sticking point for me is whether that could be worked on a little more. But I certainly, the Piad does allow you to put a bedroom on. It does allow upward building. Certainly, I don't see anywhere where it protects anyone's view, and I would agree with the applicant there as well. But I'm just kind of stuck over the not more detrimental one. It's a real sensitive issue when the property line buildings are that close. So that's where I am right now.
Okay. Chairman Ciampetti here. Thank you, Mr. Moore. Any further deliberations on the special permit criteria or any other
applications? Yeah, I guess I'd like to chime in. This is Ken Swanton. It's kind of tough because out on Plum Island, quite a few houses have been enabled to get much larger. So it's hard to say to the next one, why you too? Why should you too? But I just wonder if they all get much larger, what does that do to the ecosystem out there? And I think that's why we have more stringent zoning out there in the first place, because of the flood zones and the sea level rise and the agreements that were mentioned with Newbury and the water district and everything. And I as I read what's in front of us here, we have to decide whether this proposal is substantially more detrimental than what's there now. I think the answer we got from the applicant, no, we have to compare it to what they might build instead. And that's a wrinkle I hadn't thought about, but I think the law that's in front of me here is compared to what's there now. And I hate to say it to anybody, well, you can't expand your house, but if everybody did on Plum Island, what would that do to Plum Island as far as the delicate ecosystem that's there? So that's what I'm really stuck on this one. I'm just kind of stuck. So I'll leave it there.
Mr. Swanton, this Chairman Rob Ciampetti again. So just as purposes of guidance only, under 9B2, the standard for our review and deliberations when it comes to special permits for non-conformities, it is a tricky standard, and it's rather subjective, but it is, nonetheless what it is. But it reads as follows, that we must, in order to find in the affirmative, in order to find favorably for an application for a special permit for nonconformities, we must determine that the application will not be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the pre-existing nonconforming use or structure. So it's not substantially more detrimental than the existing structure, but rather substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood. And while we take sort of the fabric of everything we hear, including immediate abutters, but also we have to run that through the lens of the rest of, the structures in the neighborhood. If we're being, if we're being intellectually fair to the standard. So I'll just throw that out there for nothing more than guidance, but I wanted to just point that out since it just, since it's coming up now.
Thank you.
Sure. Mr. Chair, this is Stephen Delisle. I think you're correct, but I think there's another wrinkle, and we have to look at section 21G of the ordinance, particularly 4A, which is special permits for nonconformities in the PIOD. And that tells us that we have to analyze whether it's substantially more detrimental to than the existing nonconforming structure to the neighborhood or the PIOD. So we have to take the PIOD into consideration as well.
I agree with that. I agree with that, Stephen. All right.
And so if I may go into my deliberation, uh, I I find this to be a difficult application as well. There certainly have been some efforts to discuss with the near abutter this application, and that seems to have gone one way one day and another way another day. So that's an interesting circumstance, and the Piod issue is interesting also, and I understand Mr. Swanton's perception and perspective on the Piod issue, but I'm wondering, with respect to what's in the ground, the applicant indicates that will not be changed, and I wonder if that, you know, the whether that becomes more detrimental than what is there currently, if there's no change to really what's in the earth. So that's an issue for me. But this is a tough one.
I think that's fair to say. Any further deliberations?
Hi, this is Bud Chang. I just wanted to give you my thoughts. I think the applicant's done a reasonably good job in, you know, trying to fit this modification into the neighborhood. I don't think it's not in keeping with what's been done out there. I like the other members, I think still have concern over the overall effect on the Piod. And, you know, one of the things that I agree they're saying they're not going to change the foundation, so there's no detrimental effect, if you will, to the ground that the building's going to sit on. So the only thing that comes to my mind, because it's mentioned within the Piod, is the water in the sewer. I know it's an extremely minor change, additional bedroom, but if, you know, if we go back in time, sewer systems were all based on the number of bedrooms, how much throughput, you know, anyone home would contribute. And again, this is extremely minor. This is probably, you know, tenths of a percent of the overall system. You know, but I think as some of the other members are struggling with, if we continue to do this, we do infringe on the ability of the entire infrastructure out there to support bigger and bigger homes. So that's my only concern. Is that one piece, the way it may affect the infrastructure of Plum Island itself, both water and sewer.
Mr. Chair, this is Lisa Mead. If I could just, as a point of information that that the member just raised, I think would be helpful.
Go ahead, Attorney Mead.
So the member just raised the issue related to Title V, and that was an intricate part of the negotiations related to the adoption of the PIOD and the entry into the administrative consent order, and the City of Newburyport and Town of Newbury receiving low interest loans to build the sewer system. In fact, that was the main driving factor behind whether or not a person could modify their pre-existing non-conforming home. And so that is specifically why there is a limitation on the number of bedrooms that can be added. And that's how the system was designed. And so in this instance, we have two bedrooms currently and you're allowed to add one. You may not go more than three bedrooms. And so just for your information, a Title V system is calculated on 110 gallons per bedroom. And so this would be an additional 110 gallons per bedroom for this particular structure. And that's the way the system was designed. And that's why those limitations are in the PIOD. And it's very important to comply with those limitations so as not to overwhelm the water and sewer system. This board in the past has been very careful not to grant variances, for example, on FAR, on what people might consider, quote, living space as opposed to bedroom space. And then adds in instances in the past have limited that additional space to not be bedrooms so as not to have an impact over the original three bedrooms on the water sewer system. So you raise a really, really good point, but that's exactly why the PIOD was adopted, to limit the number of bedrooms, which is what the PIOD does, which is why this is entirely consistent with the PIOD, because it doesn't exceed that. And so its impact on the PIOD was contemplated and it doesn't exceed it and certainly would not be substantially more detrimental to it. So thank you.
Thank you, Attorney Mead. Chairman Ciampetti here. Any further deliberations from members of the board? Okay, hearing no further deliberations. So, I mean, I'll just share sort of my deliberations and I agree with all the members of the board that have opined as to the challenge and the difficulty and certainly the sensitivity of an application like this. And with, of course, the greatest deference and respect to the immediate abutters, the Murrays, whose home is couldn't be closer, as it were. And Mr. and Mrs. Murray and Adam Murray, all of whom spoke passionately in support of the impacts as it pertains to them, I certainly want to say thank you for taking the time to share those thoughts with us. So just my thoughts on the standard. As we all know, this board is governed by a stricture that's fairly rigid when it comes to, the legal adherence to the criteria, though we're not robots, of course. So we can be organic and we can certainly be empathetic and try to understand the lay of the land. And in this instance, when we deal with the Piot in particular, it's a very strict environment of regulation. When we run it through the lens of the standard that we as members of the ZBA must deal, we're talking about a standard that is substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood. Not detrimental, not any measure of detriment, but substantial detriment, which is perceived, presumed to be something more than just the average detriment. It's hard to, for me, and I'll just share my thoughts just as one voting member, the detriment is easy to perceive as it pertains to the immediate abutters, certainly. And I take no issue with, the Murray's impact. But when we as a board must make a decision, we have to make a decision in a more macro way. We have to look at this application within itself, but also as it impacts the neighborhood. And then more generally and widely, the Piot. And so when we look at the Piot, it does contemplate a maximum of 3 bedrooms. It does contemplate an addition of 1 bedroom when 3 bedrooms isn't already pre-existing. And we, we can't escape that, reality. It also contemplates, in my estimation, that an applicant with a home such as this could go the exact opposite route within their rights and pursue permitting through the Conservation Commission under the FEMA standards to move this house up to its upward limit, which is 35 feet, the average between the eave and the peak, and put it up on pilings with parking underneath. It's pretty clear in the spirit of the Piot that keeping the compression of usable space within an existing footprint is preferred, though we see plenty of examples where properties and projects go up on pilings. I would presume that would be even more of an impact on the neighborhood and maybe certainly on the immediate abutters, the Murrays, with respect to how that might look. But be that as it may, as I just look at this as just one voting member, it's hard for me to find substantial detriment. And I say that with the greatest empathy and respect to the Murrays and their immediate impact, though I am encouraged at least to see that their view is not utterly obstructed. In fact, I'm sure they may disagree, but I would feel differently if their view is completely obstructed, even though I don't have the right as a member of the ZBA to make a decision based on that because views are just not legally protected. Though we all live in the world, we know that views are important. So, those are my thoughts and I just share them, out loud for what they're worth. Are there any other members of the ZBA who wish to further deliberate or if not, do we have a motion?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I would, this is Mark Moore. I would say that you probably encapsulated what I was trying to say when I kicked it off that no solution here is going to be perfect, but on the whole, it seems like every effort was made to do this right. And again, with all due respect to the abutters who are respectful and make an obvious and a good case, I think you encapsulated my opinion as well.
Okay, and thank you for that. Any other members wish to speak before I ask for a motion? Seeing no hands from the ZBA members, do we have a motion to approve or a motion on the application?
Yes, Mark Mayer, I'll make a motion to approve special permit for nonconformities, 1250 4th Street, number 2020019.
Okay, motion's been made. Do we have a second?
Bud Chang, and I'll second that motion.
Okay, motion's been made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Channon. I will call the roll, and if I can ask you to just please give your name and your yay or nay vote. Mr. Moore.
Mark Moore, A, yes.
Mr. Delisle. Mr. Delisle, no.
Mr. Channon.
Mr. Shagnon, yay.
Mr. Swanton.
Mr. Swanton, no.
And Chairman Ciampetti, I vote yay. Okay, so.
Mr. Ciampetti.
Yes.
This is Lisa Mead. If I could ask the board to reconsider their current vote and allow us to continue the matter and come back to you.
Okay, well, we haven't concluded the roll call and finalized it. So though just on the wire, certainly that is your right, Attorney Mead. If you wish to request a continuance, we can suspend the consummation of the voting and go back out to the board with a request to step back and try to rethink or rework this. Members of the board, you just heard Attorney Mead request that we suspend the consummation of our voting on the application and that she, on behalf of her applicant, step back to attempt to try to rework this, I presume to improve upon it. Do we have any members of the board, do any members of the board object to that, or do any members of the board wish to speak with respect to that?
This is Ken Swanton. I think that's a good idea.
Okay. Anyone else? Thank you, Ken. All right, seeing no hands. So Chairman Ciampetti here again. So what I'll do is I will ask the board for a motion to continue the matter. Attorney Mead, how long do you feel you need?
Why don't we do to your next meeting for right now, and then if we're not able to get ready, we'll do a continuance.
Okay.
If that's possible, if you have an opening.
Thank you, Attorney Mead. Andy, what's the docket look like on our next meeting, or Caitlin, if you can tell me?
Yeah, sorry. I believe it's you've got a full docket right now. It depends on, I guess, how quickly you move along with agenda items. Right now, your agenda has been lined up for that date. I don't know if Caitlin wants to add anything to that.
Yeah, it's pretty full at this point. But if we can do this quickly, perhaps we can make space.
If I may make a suggestion, I think part of the question might be, is there enough latitude on the part of the boards, look at this application to warrant a continuance? Is it likely that the applicant may be able to change the perspective of the board? And I have no objection to that either way. But if it's likely that there's some flexibility there, would make sense to have a continuance. If not, then, if it's not going to change the outcome, let's say.
Yeah, no, and Andy, thank you for that. But I think that in all fairness, without really sort of knowing what the future holds on what they're contemplating, I'm going to err on the side of deference and allow them to request a continuance. And as long as, we can at least, attempt in earnest to put them on the next agenda. And if it looks like we can't get to them, then it would have to be further continued. Attorney Mead, would that be acceptable if we did that?
Yeah, that would be fine. And we would certainly respect the board's time. And if we're not ready, make sure that we ask for a continuance as well.
Okay. Thank you, Attorney Mead. That's fair enough. Okay. So members of the board, if I can have a motion to continue, and we'll continue this in earnest, with best efforts to getting toward it, with getting to it next time. But if we can't, we can't. But if I can get a motion to continue at the applicant's request, the matter to the next scheduled hearing of the ZBA.
May 12th.
May 12th, okay.
Thank you, Andy.
This is Mark Moore, and I'll make a motion to suspend the vote and continue this matter at the request of the applicant to our next meeting of May 12th.
Second, Ken Swanton. Okay, so we have a motion by Mr. Moore, and I didn't catch the second. Was it Mr. Delisle or Mr. Swanton?
It was Mr. Delisle.
Okay, motion's made by Mr. Moore, seconded by Mr. Delisle. I'll call the roll and just answer in the affirmative or negative. Mr. Swanton.
Mr. Swanton, yes.
Mr. Moore.
Mr. Moore, yes.
Mr. Delisle.
Mr. Delisle, yes.
And Mr. Chanyon.
Mr. Chanyon, yay.
Chairman Ciampetti, I vote yes. Five in the affirmative. The ayes have it. The motion carries and the matter is continued to the meeting of May 12th. Thank you to all of those that have spoken, to the Murrays, Mr. Sava, and to the applicants in the attorney meeting. And why don't we move along to the next matter on the agenda, which is the application of 40 Low Street. 40 Low Street is the applicant is the City of Newburyport Parks Department, matter 2020-021, a sign variance to allow a freestanding sign. May we hear from the applicant on behalf of the City of Newburyport Parks Department?
This is Andy Port. I'm just allowing Liz Reed, who is our Director of Parks, and Chris Huntress, who is the consultant who's developed plans for this particular set of improvements.
All right, thank you.
This is Lisa Reed, Parks Director for the city. We are requesting a freestanding sign at the west side of the entrance to the Bradley Fuller Park on Low Street. It's to replace a sign that was installed on the fence to the east side of the entrance to the park. When we renovated the track itself a couple of years ago, we installed a shorter fence, which is no longer appropriate for mounting a sign on. We would like the sign to be closer to the road. We looked at some other placements within the park for the sign. Our preference is to have the sign for the park closer to the road so that people can identify the park as they arrive. And so I'd like Chris Huntress to fill in the rest of the details from here.
I am here. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and the board. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
This is the chairman. I can hear you, Mr. Huntress, as well.
Right. For the record, Chris Huntress with Huntress Associates with Landscape Architects out of Andover. I'm working with the city for some time on this project. For the board's benefit, you should be aware the Planning Board and Conservation Commission have both approved this project recently. I think that's happened since we've last spoken, so I wanted to just put that in for the record. The variance is for a freestanding sign, and it's really driven by the unique size of the parcel and the longstanding use as a public park and recreation facility. As you may be aware, the project's in a residential zone. However, being a public park and a parcel of such significant size, it really needs a better and freestanding sign at its entry so that it can be identified for folks who are trying to find it for those purposes. The unique conditions are not a result of action taken by the city subsequent to the adoption of the ordinance, and the relief will not constitute a grant of special privilege inconsistent with limitations upon other properties in the district. The sign itself is about 6 feet wide, 5 feet tall. It is the body of the sign, being just the wood part that you see between the two granite posts, contains about 16 square feet that would face Low Street, and it would be 14 feet into the property, 14 feet setback from the property line, as shown on the plans, just to the left of the new revised entry. With that, I'll stop, and I'm happy to take any questions that the board may have.
This is Chairman Ciampetti. Thank you, Mr. Huntress. We certainly may have some questions. I'll just poll the virtual audience. Does anyone wish to speak in support of the application, the sign application? Seeing among the attendees, no hands raised, I'll move on. Does anyone wish to speak in opposition to the application? Seeing no hands raised from the virtual attendees, I'll close that section of the public hearing and move to questions from the board.
This is Stephen Delisle. I'll jump in here. Mr. Huntress, my question, and Ms. Reed, my question is with respect to your comment, Mr. Huntress, about the visibility, is the sign parallel to Low Street or perpendicular to Low Street? It looks from the materials that it's parallel to Low Street, which makes me wonder how it increases or provides any visibility to anybody trying to come through the field on Low Street.
It is parallel to Low Street, much in the way that the original sign was when it was hung on the fence there some time ago.
Yeah, the original sign you could only see from Graff Road, and it was impossible to see from Low Street.
I think this will have quite a bit of visibility from Low Street. We could look into a double-sided sign if we wanted to turn it 90 degrees, if that was the board's preference. Be happy to consider that.
Mr. Chair, this is Andy Port. If you would mind, I'd like to interject a comment there.
Yeah, please, Andy, go ahead.
Thank you. And I apologize actually both to Liz Reed and to Chris Huntress that I hadn't noticed this issue before, but I actually agree with the comment that was just made about the visibility of the sign. I think it would do much better in its purpose if it was a two-faced sign, double-faced and oriented perpendicular. It's the same reason why in downtowns we have the blade signs sticking out from the building, face of the building, because it's easier to see from down the street. So I think that would be a beneficial change. And if it was approved in the same footprint, perpendicular on center, I think that would be sufficient. But that's my thought on that.
And this is Lisa Reed. We're happy to consider that change.
Ms. Reed, thank you. This is Chairman Ciampetti again. So if I'm understanding correctly, if we're to modify, if what the Parks Department is asking for is a modification of the design to a blade sign that's double-sided, is everything else that is proposed as proposed what you would anticipate actually building on site for the signage? Will nothing else change?
No, nothing else would change, Mr. Chairman. It would be a simple matter of rotating that sign 90 degrees and specifying that it be double-sided, which we can do with an MDO product quite simply. So it really wouldn't be a significant change to the plan at all.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. Were there any other questions from the board? While we're waiting, I've got a question, and this is a question for Mr. Huntress. Could you just walk us through the materials again for the signage, specifically, finish materials and lighting?
I'd be happy to. So the two posts, I don't know if you can zoom out, Andy, so that we can see the detail of the sign. Here you go. The two posts on either side that support the sign are 10-inch by 10-inch granite posts with a thermal finish and a point to the top. And the sign itself is a MDO, which is a high density foam product that would be painted. It actually would look like a wood carved sign. You wouldn't know the difference between that and a wood carved. It just won't rot over time. And we've done these quite a bit, and you can double side this. So it would be fully engraved, painted, and with recessed letters and the city seal at the top, just the way you see it there. The only thing that would definitely change is the dedication date of May 1, 2020. I think we've all realized that we're not going to hit that date. So some flexibility on that would be warranted, but that's it in a nutshell. I hope that answers your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Huntress. And a quick dovetail on that question. Could you speak to the lighting? I'm assuming external lighting, but will it be ground-based upwash lighting, or is there some other lighting contemplated?
Actually, I'm not sure that lighting is proposed at this time. We haven't run, but we don't have power out to that location presently. But if the board wanted to condition lights, we could add that to the plan and do an uplight from the ground, which would probably be the simplest way to light that sign.
Well, and again, this is Chair Ciampetti. No, I'm not proposing lighting. I just want to make sure that the plan that I, as I see it, lighting is an important piece of whenever we're considering freestanding sign applications, specifically the, you know, the light pollution component. So we've evolved over the years. We won't say a standard, but rather best practices when it comes to what we like to ask and what we prefer to see. If there's no lighting proposed, we're certainly not going to ask you to put lighting in, or at least I'm not. But I just figured I'd ask the question so that the members of the board could hear definitively that there's nothing here that we're missing.
There is no lighting proposed. The sports field and the track don't have lighting either, so there is no significant intended use. There is a little bit of lighting proposed in the parking lot just for people to kind of find their way out at dusk. But other than that, it's not intended to be used in the evening, so there was no intention to light the sign.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Huntress. Moving along, further questions from members of the board? Seeing no hands of the members, and we'll close that segment of the hearings and move to deliberations. And for purposes of deliberations, and I'll just share the standard, we're considering a freestanding sign. So freestanding signs are only permitted, as we know from the staff report, they are only permitted by right in the industrial zone or in the AgCon district. So no freestanding signs are permitted unless without relief of the board. So this is a special permit that's being requested. If I direct the board members' attention without rereading it, in order, and I'm sorry, this is a variance criteria. This is variance criteria. If you can refer to the office's staff report, the planning office's staff report, section 10H, the criteria for a variance, and guide your deliberations along those lines, that would be great.
Well, this is Mark Moore. I'll try to jump off on this one too. I would agree with the applicant that in seeking a variance for this freestanding sign, that I would agree that the conditions and circumstances are unique to this lot. I don't see a lot of other parks and tracks up in the area. So this is a unique and would not apply to neighboring lands. It's very reasonable to have signage to get people into a park like this. So a reasonable use of the lot would be to sign it so that for safety reasons, people can come and go. So I think that that's satisfied with this proposal. Obviously, there's been nothing done by the applicant to make this happen other than, you know, wanting to sign for safety reasons subsequent to the adoption of the chapter. And it's not going to be a special privilege given the nature of the project and the reason for the signing. So for me, I think it meets all the criteria of a variance.
Yeah, this is Ken Swanton. I think that was just summed up very, very well by Mr. Moore. It's a very unique situation. It's in an agricultural conservation zone. I mean, so it's, I have no problem with this.
This is Stephen Delisle. I would agree with Mr. Swanton and Mr. Moore. I don't really see Mr. Moore's safety aspect of this. I mean, this is just for entering and exiting the newly approved parking area, but nonetheless, a sign identifying the field is a capital idea.
This is Bud Shagnon, and I'm also in agreement, and I think the size of the sign is appropriate. Obviously, 9 square feet probably would be too small for what we're proposing here, but I think what they are proposing is a good size, and it'll do the job for which it's intended. So I'm in agreement as well.
Okay, this is Chairman Ciampetti. I agree with all of the comments of my colleagues and members of the board. Do we have a motion?
I'll keep going. Mark Moore, I'll make a motion to approve the variance application for 40 Low Street, file number 2020-027.
Seconded by Ken Swanton.
Okay, the motion's been made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Swanton. We'll call the roll on the approval. Mr. Swanton.
Approved.
Mr. Moore.
Yes.
Mr. Delisle.
Mr. Delisle, yes.
Mr. Chenyon.
Chenyon, yay.
Chairman Champetti, I vote yay, 5 in the affirmative. The motion carries and the variance is approved. I want to thank you, Mr. Huntress and Ms. Reed for the presentation and good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Have a good night. Okay. We'll move along to our next matter. The next application before the board is the property of 249-251 Water Street, Michael and Karen Costello, care of Lisa Mead, Mead, Tellerman, and Costa. This matter is continued from March 24th, 2020. The application is docket 2020-028, a special permit for nonconformities to revert a two-family residence into a single-family residence and construct additions at the rear and eastern side. May we hear from the applicant, Attorney Mead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Lisa Mead, Mead, Tellerman and Costa, 30 Green Street, on behalf of Karen and Mike Costello. And with me this evening, not actually, figuratively, is Karen and Mike, as well as Eileen Graff, who is the architect on the project. This, for the members of the board who may not know, unless you read all of my materials, was once the South End Gun Club. And it is currently a two-family house. The proposal is to convert it back into a single family. In order to do that, the applicant needs a special permit for nonconformities because it's going to make a couple of minor changes to the house. The property is located in the Agricultural Conservation District, the Demolition Control Overlay District, and the Floodplain Overlay District. Andy, if you could go to the site plan, that would be great. The two-family use on the property is pre-existing non-conforming as it's currently prohibited in the Agricultural Conservation District. And for a single-family use in the Agricultural Conservation District, the size of the lot, the frontage, and the lot coverage are also non-conforming, as it would have been, of course, if it was a two-family. The property measures 4,352 square feet, or a minimum of 400,000 square feet are required. The required frontage is 300 feet, where it has 48 feet on Water Street. The maximum allowable lot coverage is 3%, and the lot coverage of the property is 30.6. The structure is pre-existing non-conforming for all of the setbacks. The AgCon require 50 feet on all sides. The structure has a front yard setback of 3.1, side yard setback of 11.3 to the east and 3.1 to the west, and a rear yard setback of 39.4 feet. The structure's height is 29 feet, which is in compliance with the maximum allowable 30 feet in the district, and that will not change. Under 9B2A of the ordinance, we are seeking to extend the pre-existing non-conforming rear yard setback by an upward extension and a movement out slightly. The current rear yard setback is 39.4, and we propose it at 31.6, so just about 8 feet. And we're going to upwardly extend the side yard setbacks and slightly intensify the lot coverage from 36.6 to 33.8. The proposed renovation will include what I'm going to have Eileen go over shortly, and that is a renovation to the back addition and the interior of the project. And before I get into the details on the actual significance of the project and how we are complying with the VE flood zone, I'm gonna let Eileen talk about the proposed renovations and architectural plans. So maybe you could switch to those, Andy.
I
Hi, this is Eileen Graff speaking. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board. So if we could, Andy, are you going to propose? Thank you. So to start with, we were, as Lisa mentioned, we discovered the history of the building and discovering that it was a South End gun club. And this was exciting to find the rendering of what it was its original tent was. So that became our inspiration as far as where we'd like to draw from. And we wanted to bring back some of the original features, the historic features that were there at one time. And starting in the front elevation, we wanted to bring back the covered front porch. So you'll see on the left top drawing, drawing number one, the front elevation, the current front single story structure is all enclosed at the moment. It's a shed roof, and we want to bring back the openness that it once had with the exposed columns, etc. There's you know, a quarter of it we're going to have enclosed as we're trying to house some of the mechanical needs at a higher level. But for the most part, bringing back that openness that was once there. Other things, other features that we're bringing back are the detailing at the casing, and you'll notice that on the second floor level windows, also seen in the original rendering, and also bringing back some of the siding of a combination of clapboards and shingles. So that's the changes on the front, bringing back to the original form. We then turn to the side and can see some of these same elements, the single windows. Thank you, Andy. Sort of continuing down the original structure, and you could see it there in the second drawing. Also in this elevation, you will see this single story shed, and that is a structure that exists right now. It's a sunroom. It has a failing foundation level, and so we are rebuilding that structure on a new foundation and building it back to the same one-story level with the shed roof as well. And you can see that on the rear, where you see the proposed covered porch, the original structure, actually, you can go back to, oh, that's good too. The original structure, actually, Andy, do you mind going back to the last one? It's almost clearer as you go up. Thank you. You will see that on the second floor level, the structure overhangs the footprint below. And that's a condition that actually exists today. It currently cantilevers 2 feet, and we are going to just extend that cantilever just a hair more. It's 4 feet out on the second level beyond what originally exists. And likewise, the covered porch stretches out with it, and that is just another 4 feet there in extension towards the rear yard. So that is the change towards the river. Then if you travel to the third floor, the changes on the third floor, we're adding 2 shelf dormers, one on each side. Important for the use of this structure, it provides much needed headroom and light. We've kept them really narrow with these low transoms. We've stepped them back from the gable ends, 3'7", as well as from the eave ends, and from the sides, from the eave ends, they're stepping in 2'6". So really keeping it in the middle of this structure as close to the ridge as possible. As far as materials for the structure, again, siding, we're picking up on what's of the vernacular, a combination of shingles and clapboards. In some areas, we will be going with a wider boarding in areas towards the river. The metal is proposed to be a standing seam roof. But those are the changes to the structure. And I'll let Lisa continue with more details.
Thank you, Andy. Do you have the presentation package that we emailed to the office last week? Because it has photos of the existing conditions as well as the actual South End Gun Club.
Yeah, just was that actually, was that posted? Hang on just 1 second. Let me take a look.
It was provided to the office last week.
Bear with us just a second. Let's see what we have it here. I'm seeing it. Perhaps it wasn't posted. Caitlin, do you happen to have access to that? It looks like it wasn't posted to the website with the site plans.
I do have it. Give me a moment. Yep. I just sent it to you, Andy.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you. Yeah, I'll just ask if something like that comes in, let's we'll make sure that gets posted to the website. Now, Lisa, is that the PDF you're looking for?
It's all, it's, if you open that PDF, it's got everything in it.
Okay. Okay, how about that?
Nope, that would be back on Plum Island.
Caitlin, is that the right file you sent me, Caitlin?
Andy, do you have the ability to let me share my screen?
Yeah, I would like to address the issue whether or not we're having an issue on our end. Caitlin, is that the file you just sent me, or?
Yeah, I'm trying to find that, Andy. So maybe we'll let Lisa share her screen at this point.
Yeah, okay. If you could check with Diane and make sure that anything else that comes from Attorney Mead or others gets to the website, that'll make sure we don't have that issue again. Hang on 1 second. I'd just like to make sure we don't run into that kind of situation again.
Okay, so I can share my screen now, if that's okay?
It's visible, I think, yep.
All right, hang on. So this is all you. That's all you. Oh, here we go. Hang on.
I think you might have to change the PDF that you've got open, or the browser maybe that you're looking through.
Hang on a second.
Caitlin, have you been able to locate or forward that file to me so I could pull it up maybe as well?
I'm checking through my email right now. I'm not seeing it. Lisa, do you know which date it was sent on?
All right. Can you see that? Yeah, I sent it last week, and then I sent it again and reminded everybody, and you all acknowledged that you had it. So that's okay. Can you see that?
All right. It's appearing to me. Yep.
I can see it as well, Lisa.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Great. So here's the site plan. And what we wanted to show you was the condition of the existing. So here's the existing structure. And what's important about this is the enclosed porch that Eileen had talked about that we want to bring back to what we're going to show you shortly. This structure is in the middle of the Joppa Historic District, and it's also in the FEMA VE flood zone. Here's a front picture of it. As a result, if there's any construction on this that's more than a substantial improvement, it needs to come into compliance with the current FEMA requirements for construction, which would require this to go to an elevation 18 at the bottom of the first member. And this structure would have to be put on piling. So you can see, here's the Joppa, a lot of these historic houses. These are first period houses in the Joppa Historic District. And because of the history we found here, and this is the rear of the structure. So Eileen was talking about how this is going to be extended out a little bit and that will be filled in the bottom. Here's that enclosed porch on the side. Again, here's another photo of the rear. And so we, of course, don't want to do that. And one of the exceptions to the, this is looking east, one of the exceptions to the FEMA flood requirements, and here's the photo that we have found from an old newspaper of the South End Gun Club, just to give you an idea. One of the exceptions is that if you have a house that is deemed historic, and that after the renovations, it remains historic, then you don't have to do this. So here's what the requirement would be in order for us to comply with the current FEMA flood requirements. So Mike and Karen don't want to do this. The Historic Commission obviously doesn't want us to do this. And so our proposal was to get an exception from the FEMA requirements and to build this as resilient as possible and to then take into consideration this and be sympathetic to obviously what the original structure was and what the new structure is proposed to be. And so we've complied with the exception so far. The Historic Commission has declared this to be historic given its history. It's listed as contributory. And then it's part of the Joppa Historic District as well. And they said that even after these renovations, it will continue to carry on with that designation. So we need a special permit for nonconformities because of the exacerbation and going up on the right side slightly. That is nonconforming over here in the rear and then encroaching more on the rear yard setback back here. Originally, we had proposed a second floor over this side addition, and our neighbor across the street on the waterside side of the street, Frank Cousins, requested we not have a second floor there. And so Mike and Karen removed that second floor. Similarly, to the house to the west, Betsy Nietzsche, originally we had proposed this to be a full building right here. This be the second floor would actually come all the way out on this elevation. She requested that be moved back 2 feet to allow that view through there to continue. And we, Mike and Karen, reduced the size of that second floor bump out in that location. And so the applicant is here to ask that the board grant a special permit for nonconformities. We are not creating any new nonconformities, and we're certainly not making it substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood for a number of reasons. I might add that one of the reasons that this, one of the advantages to this side addition being removed and rebuilt is the city has a drain line that runs directly under here for which there is no easement. So Karen and Mike are obviously gonna keep it on their property, but it's gonna be moved out from underneath the building during construction. And we've been working with the city to accomplish that. So the reduction in intensity of use of this parcel from a two family to a one family is more in keeping with the district. There are modest, and I would suggest that these improvements are small and they're a slight impact on the setbacks that already are non-conforming. All of the materials are of high quality, and Eileen has done her level best to bring back some of the important details of the South End Gun Club. And Mike and Karen have worked with their neighbors to make sure that the improvements that they are making to the house are sympathetic to those around it. And so we request that the board consider the granting of a special permit for nonconformities and that the proposal is not substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood.
Thank you, Attorney Mead. And Was there anything further in the application that you or Eileen wanted to present, or can we move to comments from the public?
I think we're all set at this point.
Okay, great. All right, closing then that part of the presentation of our hearing. Is there anyone in the virtual attendees who wishes to speak in support of the application? Seeing no hands, anyone wish to speak in opposition? Seeing no hands, I'll close that part of the public hearing and open it up to questions from the board. Anyone have any questions?
This is Stephen Delisle. I have a question for Attorney Mead. One of the things I noticed was that the NHC approved the plans, or approved your plans at a meeting on February 13th, 2020. And then you have some new plans that you showed us tonight. Have those plans been approved, or where does that stand with the NHC?
Thank you, Mr. Delisle. These do not have to go back to the NHC because they didn't impact those. The NHC reviewed the plans without the second floor over this side. They reviewed this plan. We made the change to that railing right there that they asked. And the only other change was this step back in the rear, and they had no comments in the rear. So the planning office was in agreement that the NHC did not need to see this again.
Oh, that's good news then.
Sure is.
Okay, any other questions from the board?
Yeah, this is Ken Swanton. There's a lot I like about this plan. I just had one quick question, which is, you're encroaching more back toward the river there, but I think I see in your drawing that the first floor is an open porch. Am I reading the drawing correctly?
That's correct. And in fact, that open porch is gonna be built in conformance with the floodplain requirements. So part of it's open. Eileen, maybe you could talk a little bit more about the design there.
Sure. Eileen Graff again. So there was importance to building this open, and also the fact that we're going to build this with a concrete foundation wall. One of the things, we brought in Lisa O'Donnell, an engineer in Essex, Mass, as a consultant on this project. With the history of the original house and its proximity to the water, there was concerns about rising tides and what it would do to the original brick foundation. And one of the things she talked about was how if we built this covered porch and a poured concrete foundation, it would help to protect the original foundation, original structure. So we saw that as an opportunity to gain this covered porch aspect, but as well as protect the original structure.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, any further questions from the board? Seeing none, we'll close that section of the hearing and move to deliberations. And for purposes of deliberations, this is, as we all know, this is a special permit for nonconformities under 9B2. And the board, as is in our advisory report from the planning office, the board must find that there will be no addition of a new nonconformity in order to grant this special permit. And that the proposed addition will not also create a new nonconformity. We also have to find that the proposed alterations will not be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the pre-existing nonconforming use or structure. And we consider as part of that factor such as size, scale, massing, and volume as compared to the other structures in the neighborhood. So if we could just kind of focus in our deliberations around those criteria.
Oh, this is Mark Moore. I'll jump off again saying I really like the proposal. I can see, or we know that it doesn't create a new nonconformity, but in looking at the question of more detrimental to the neighborhood than pre-existing, No, it's really a thoughtful, well worked project. Worked with the abutters to not encroach on views, which is also very very helpful in not having any opposition at all to this. And a thoughtful work, I guess, with that additional seawall being added into the design. So I can't see it being as presented. It's not, certainly to me, not more detrimental in any way to the neighborhood or neighboring homes at all. So.
This is Ken Swanton. I'll just chime in here. I think I was originally concerned this is an agricultural conservation zone, so the standards are very high. So it's, of course, out of conformance in all areas. But I think they've done a very sensitive plan here, one that they've worked closely with the abutters, as has been said. And I think this, and I'm happy to hear about my question on the open porch in the back. They didn't really encroach on the river as I first thought when I just looked at the plot plan. So I think this is good.
This is Stephen Delisle. I would agree. Nice plan. Very nice plan. Nice presentation. The only thing is that the FEMA exception being obtained, I guess that everything would be subject to that being obtained by the applicant.
If I could, Mr. Chair.
Go ahead, attorney.
So, Mr. Delisle, you're correct. So, we've met the first part of that, and then we have to go to CONCOM next, and then they have to agree with the design, and then the building inspector has to agree. But the it's not a variance under the state building code. It's actually a pure exception that if you meet that designation, it's an automatic exception so long as the CONCOM and the building inspector agree.
Oh, okay, excellent.
Okay, any further deliberations? Seeing none, I'll just say that I concur with members of the board that have spoken. I commend the applicant on the sort of sensitive approach to this. I think it certainly is not by any means more substantially more detrimental. I think it's an adaptive reuse of a historic property, and I think it's sensitive to a number of interwoven factors. Certainly, I can approve it. I can support it. Does anyone else on the board wish to speak as part of deliberations before I close this section and go to a vote? Seeing no hands, I will then go out to the board. Do we have a motion?
Well, this is Mark Moore. To keep with continuity, I'll make a motion to approve special permit for nonconformities for 249-251 Water Street, file number 2020-028.
Seconded, Ken Swanton.
Okay, motion is made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Swanton. And before we pull the board, one thing I failed to note, that the application does appear to trigger the tree and sidewalk ordinance, but as per DPS, their recommendations are both that the sidewalk looks sufficient and also that there are no room for trees. So there is no need to condition our approval, which we're about to vote on either of those two factors, but we just noted for the record. So again, the motion is made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Swanton. I'll pull the board. Mr. Swanton.
Swanton, aye.
Mr. Moore.
Moore, yes.
Mr. Delisle.
Mr. Delisle, yes.
Mr. Chanion.
Mr. Chanion, yes.
And Chairman Ciampetti, I vote yes as well. That's 5 in the affirmative. The motion carries and the special permit for nonconformities is approved. Thank you, Attorney Mead. And also thank you, Ms. Graff, and good luck. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, board.
Okay. All right, guys, moving to our last application this evening. We have the application before us for a special permit for nonconformities on the property located at 78 Middle Street. 78 Middle Street is matter docket number 2020-029. Special permit for nonconformities to demolish and reconstruct a pre-existing nonconforming accessory structure in the same location. May we, and this is the matter of Blake and Margot Witherington. And may we hear from Mr. and Mrs. Witherington?
Hi, this is Blake Witherington. Michael Graff, who's our architect and contractor, is also on the line, or should be. And he was the one who was going to be making the presentation this evening.
All right. Hello, board.
I think you can hear me now, right?
We can.
Okay. Good evening. Thanks for convening this hearing. This is Michael Graff, architect. I'm here with Blake Witherington for 78 Middle Street. Blake and Margot have been Newburyport residents since 2013 and have done substantial improvements to their historic home over the past several years. The property has an existing garage. Dimensions are about 20'6" by 32'3", with an existing loft space above. Currently, the loft space is accessed by a ladder in the midpoint of the garage. The garage is in a state of disrepair, and it's undergone numerous kind of shoddy repairs in the years prior to my client's ownership. Our proposal is to remove the existing structure and replace it with a structure of the exact same footprint. We're seeking relief for an upward extension at the south rear elevation and for the over 500 square foot rule, the 9B3. The upward extension is needed to gain code legal access to the second floor level of the structure. And while we are adding a dormer on the west elevation, the ridge height of the proposed structure will not exceed the ridge height of the existing structure. So Andy, if you go to AO1, you can see the existing schematic section, drawing number 4 on the far right, and then the proposed, that's actually the proposed schematic section, the existing's above it, but that ridge height would remain the same. What we're adding to is to the rear of the structure, to the south side, there's a shed roof at about the back third of the building, and we'd like to remove that shed roof and continue the main ridge back to the edge of the rear elevation, as well as add the dormer on the west side for light and ventilation. We've been before the Historic Commission. They've approved the proposed demolition of the existing structure. Now, I initially designed this project with a brick facade and a single door on the north elevation. The existing 78 Middle Street is a brick house. So I was interested in a brick facade and then shingle on the rest of the building. Since that time, my clients decided that they would prefer to have a clapboard facade on the front and shingle on the sides and rear, which is consistent with a lot of the historic outbuildings. We would still maintain a brick shelf. So the bottom 8 inches would have a historic brick before it goes to the wood body of the house. Let's see, that's about it as far as description of the architecture. Blake, if there are any questions regarding the historic result, the meeting with the Historic Commission, maybe you could speak to those, and I'll take any questions.
Okay, this is Chair Champetti again. Thank you, Mr. Graff. And Mr. Witherington, do you want to continue with the presentation or do you feel you're all set for now? We certainly will have questions as we go into that section.
Sure. No, I think Michael's covered it pretty well already. I'm happy to answer any questions about the Historic Commission meeting, which I was able to attend, but Michael was not in February. So.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Witherington. So closing that presentation section of our hearing, I will go out to members of the virtual public. Anyone wish to speak in support of the application? If you could just raise your hand and Andy Port will unmute your mic and we'll hear from you. Seeing no hands?
I see none at the moment, Chair.
Okay. Anyone wish to speak in opposition? I also see no hands raised. We'll close that section of the hearing and go to questions from the board. Okay, I don't see any hands raised on questions from the board.
I'll do one question, Mr. Chair. Sure. This is Stephen DeLisle. I think I understood from Mr. Graff's presentation, but the facade will now be two doors, two garage doors and clapboards, as opposed to what was in the prior, the earlier plan with the brick facade and one door.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions?
This is Mark Moore. Just one question off that. And where again is the brick that's going to kind of continue the look? Is it going to be the bottom?
Just
the foundation.
Kind the of brick thing? Shelf. Yeah, brick at the foundation so that it maintains the look of an earlier structure.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions from the board? Seeing no hands, we'll close that portion of the hearing and move to deliberations. And again, since this is a special permit for nonconformities, the criteria that we must use is whether the board finds that the application will not be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the pre-existing nonconforming use or structure. And when making that finding, the board must consider factors such as size, scale, massing, and volume as compared to other structures in the neighborhood, and this is all criteria under 9B2.
This is Stephen DeLisle. I'll go first here this time. It appears that, you know, there's no addition of a new nonconformity and that the proposed structure will not be substantially more detrimental to the neighborhood than the existing nonconforming structure. I see no problem with the massing or anything like that. It looks like a nice plan that will fit in seamlessly with what was there before.
Yeah, this is Ken Swanton. I'll just chime in. You know, I walk by and it's kind of hard to even see the building back there, although you can see it, the tuck back there. What you can see is hardly going to change. It's going to be the exact same footprint. So, I mean, and it's from the street, it's going to look very similar. It's a nice overall property and area. I have no problem with this proposal.
That's not me. This is Mark Moore, and I would agree with my colleagues entirely. Well done proposal, very reasonable, and certainly doesn't add any detriment to the neighborhood at all.
This is Bud Shagan. I walk by this house a lot, and I think this is a great change. Again, no detriment to the neighborhood. If anything, an improvement. A great presentation. I think it looks great. I'm all for it.
Chairman Ciampetti, I agree with my colleagues. I have nothing more that I would add other than what's already been said, and I too can support it. So having finalized our deliberations, we'll close that section of the public hearing. Do we have a motion?
This is Mr. Moore, I may as well keep going. I will make a motion to approve special permit nonconformities for 78 Middle Street, file number 2020-029.
Seconded, Ken Swanton.
Okay, motion is made by Mr. Moore and seconded by Mr. Swanton. I'll call the vote. Mr. Swanton.
Aye.
Mr. Moore.
Yes.
Mr. DeLisle.
Yes.
Mr. Channon.
Mr. Shannon, aye.
And Chairman Ciampitti, I vote yes. We have four in the affirmative and one nay vote. Four in the affirmative carries the motion. The motion carries, and the application for a special permit for nonconformities is approved. Good luck, and thank you to those we've heard from, and Mr. Graff and Mr. Witherington for your time and patience and waiting to be last on the agenda this evening.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you, the board, and thanks, Andy, for being there as well.
Yes, thank you very much.
All right, members of the Zoning Board of Appeals, having concluded our docket for the meeting this evening of April 28th, we have no further public business. Is there a motion to adjourn the meeting?
Mr. Moore here, so moved.
Seconded, Council.
Okay, I think we've got a battle for second. Mr. Moore has made the motion, seconded by, was it Mr. Swanton or Delisle?
Whomever.
All right. I'll call the roll. Mr. Swanton?
Yes.
Mr. Moore?
Mr. Moore, yes.
Mr. Delisle?
Yes.
And Mr. Channon?
Mr. Channon, yes.
And Chairman Ciampitti, yes. Five in the affirmative. The motion carries, and the meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much, everyone, for your patience and for working through this sort of, you know, this sort of maiden voyage on this Zoom approach to the meeting. Andy and Caitlin, thank you guys so much for setting all of this up for us.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you all board members for your cooperation and assistance during this awkward time.
Hey, a couple of curveballs thrown at you and you handle them. So that's onward and upward.
Thank you. And any members of the public who are still on, thank you very much for your participation and your patience. And everyone have a good evening and stay safe and stay healthy.
Thanks, everyone.
You too, Rob. Thanks. Good night.
Good night.